गुड आफ्टरनून स्टूडेंट्स, विनोद सर गुड आफ्टरनून।
आफ्टरनून सर, सर गुड आफ्टरनून।
अरुण सर, अरुण शंकर सर।
यस सर, आई कैन हियर यू।
यस सर, कैन यू प्लीज शेयर योर फर्स्ट स्लाइड सर।
आई होप आई हैव ऑलरेडी शेयर्ड इट सर, कैन यू सी दैट?
यस यस, नाउ ओनली इट इज विजिबल सर।
या
ओके। गुड आफ्टरनून स्टूडेंट्स, गुड आफ्टरनून फैकल्टी मेंबर्स हु आर ऑल जॉइंड फॉर एक्सपर्ट लेक्चर प्रोग्राम फॉर रोल ऑफ ग्राफिकल प्रोग्रामिंग लैंग्वेज इन इंडस्ट्रियल ऑटोमेशन। फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई वुड लाइक टू वेलकम टुडे स्पीकर मिस्टर अरुण शंकर फ्रॉम डैनफॉस इंडस्ट्री। द ब्रीफ बायोग्राफी ऑफ डैनफॉस मिस्टर अरुण शंकर, ही हैज कंप्लीटेड हिज बैचलर ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग फ्रॉम अन्ना यूनिवर्सिटी कोयम्बतूर and completed Master of Technology from VIT University Chennai in the year 2014, and now he is in the completion stage of Doctor of Philosophy from VIT University Vellore. And he, the main area of research it is in energy efficiency enhancement during optimal stacking, destacking of variable speed pumps in cascade control applications in collaboration with the Danfoss Industries Private Limited since July 2015 to present. Currently, he is working as a technical engineer from drive segments in the division of drive segments from Danfoss Industries, Sri Perumbatore, Chennai. Sir, welcome, sir, for our expert lecture program for the subject of 20EEE 6x3 Advanced Industrial and Building Automation subject.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you
for
the warm welcome.
Yes, sir. Now we can start your presentation, sir.
Yeah, sure, sir. Thank you. And first, I would like to thank all the participants for their interest on this topic. And I'll start the presentation. Yes. So the topic is like, what is the role of automation in industrial sector? That is mainly the topic today I'll be talking about. So this section will not be like a presentation session actually. Normally this will be like 50% is presentation, and I'll be taking you through how normally we will actually develop or model some electric drives before we actually made them into a direct product actually. I'll talk about how we model them, how we simulate them, and how we'll test them in the automation setup actually. And what are all the database that we maintain actually, normally for normally in our industry, normally how we are maintaining a database, like in case if you want to test a drive, so how we will perform the testing setups actually, so like that. And finally I'll be talking about like how the results, whatever the test results, right, how we will be analyzing them, and some case studies after completing all these things, how we have implemented some of the applications actually. So normally in case some of you might have attended my previous lecture, I have shown some of the case studies. So I have some case studies like that actually, like what are the different applications where our automated drives or drives that is playing as a major role actually. So I'll be finally dealing with some of the case studies, how things are working. So mainly in this presentation, I'll be discussing about two different automation testing platform actually. One is like many of people would be knowing it, this is LabVIEW. LabVIEW is like it's a product from National Instruments actually. So where you will be having like what to say, the simulation environment where you can able to you have a different analog and digital IOs, you have a DAC connections, so where you could be able to acquire the signals from the real time, and you can able to process them in the simulation, and then finally you can send it back to the real time world actually. So that is one way what we were doing earlier actually in our industry actually. So next one is like the Typhoon Hill actually. So what currently we are doing actually, so this is the trend that now we are working on actually, the Typhoon Hill hardware and loop technology actually. So where we have a better advantages than the National Instruments, that is LabVIEW. in terms of automation and for testing of a drive, actually, for making them as a final product, actually. So maybe I'll touch only a short topic on the LabVIEW part, but I'll touch more on the hardware and loop part, because since that is a recent trend, and people, you might have heard many lectures on the LabVIEW, and you might have seen how LabVIEW looks like, all these things, actually. But very few people would have come across the hardware and loop or the Typhoon Hill technology, those things, actually. So I'll go through, like, as a real time, I'll just open up a model, and I'll just take you through how normally how we will be developing a model in the Typhoon Hill, and how we will be running them, and how the results we will be acquiring them, actually. So it will be like similar to our SCADA or like that, actually, people who have come across the SCADA. So yes, I'll go through that, and maybe I'm not sure whether you can able to hear the audio. I thought of having a few presentation. Yes, so starting with the electric vehicle, actually. So because when it comes, the recent trend, actually, when you go for testing, automation testing, or when you go for a drive testing, whatever it is. So finally, the application, what I've taken today is like on the electric vehicle part, actually. So I'll start with how motor has been selected, actually. So these are the different types of motors, actually. Like, you have the BLDC motor, PMSM motor, asynchronous induction machines, you have a interior permanent magnet motor, and PMSRM. So these are the different types of motors, and each motor, they have their own like advantages. Like, you have for a BLDC motor, it will be very, very lesser in size, and very, like, what is it, very, very lighter in weight, actually, and it will be very simpler to control when compared to the other motors, actually. So based on its application, people, they use it in applications like electric scooters, something like that. And coming to PMSM or the induction machines, they go for commercial applications like electric buses, cars, and similarly, they go for, normally that will be picked by many of the major automobile industries like Tesla, Mahindra, so they like that, actually. So, and also, why I have highlighted those two things in green is like, for those two machines, we supply the electric drives, actually. So you can have the electric converters, DC-DC converters, you have inverters. So where you can use them as an end-user application for the electric drives, actually, for the electric vehicles. So next comes the interior permanent magnet and PMSRM. So those are not much popular when compared to the other three motors, but they still, of course, they are also can be possibly they can use for the electric vehicles, actually. So these are the different types of electric vehicles. So coming to them, why like how normally we will be selecting the motors, like why we need to select the motor, actually. So ultimately, whatever the product that comes, the efficiency is the final important matters, actually. So when it comes to the efficiency as a major part, so some of the major things that you can able to improve the efficiency is like the component selection, system dimensioning, and control adjustment. So under component selection, so here I have considered like what is it, in case if you are taking up any pumping application or any automobile applications, what are all the different components inside them, actually. So that is a major thing. And coming to the system dimensioning, like what how we are good enough to dimension the system, actually. Like, for example, when you are designing a system for 5 kilowatt or 10 kilowatt, so you should be make sure that it should be in the the particular range, actually. It should not exceed the expectation, or it should not be very, very smaller than the expected outcome, actually. So that is a proper system dimensioning. And finally, the how well we are able to control the system, actually. So when it comes to electric vehicle, so the outcome or the drive efficiency matters ultimately, actually. So when it comes to a pumping application, so how well we are going to control the pump for the required output, actually. So like those two things. When it comes to other process application, like let's say you have the conveyor application, you have the lift application, you have the crane application. So finally, the precision or the control is very, very important, actually, on in each and every application. So based on that, some application that requires very precise control, so precision matters, and some application that requires the better control, actually. So control or the speed control, that matters, actually. So based on that application, we should select a proper control algorithm or proper drive specifications, actually. So that is called your control adjustment. So these are the major or the basic things before we start any modeling, or before we start the automation testing, in any application you'll be taking care of, actually the energy efficiency part, or the I was talking about right in the earlier, the what is the motor selection, all these things actually. So these are the different motors I was talking about, like we have the induction machine, permanent magnet, synchronous machine, and the synchronous reluctance motor. So where all the three machines, when you look into that, all the three have the stator arrangements looks similar actually. You can able to see this, the induction machine, the permanent magnets machine, and the synchronous reluctance, all the machines that looks very similar when it comes to the point of rotor construction, sorry, stator construction actually. When it comes to the rotor construction, the rotor that makes the actual difference in all the three different motor types actually, either it is an induction machine, permanent magnet, or the synchronous reluctance motor. So based on that, like I have, we have decided them for a different performance, like what is the power density of an induction machine, permanent magnet machine, and the synchronous reluctance machines. So similarly, we have a different performance indices, like the cost, maintenance, noise, reliability, like this actually. So when it comes, so normally we have been using the induction machine for a very long period of time actually, like for almost like 2-3 decades we are using only the induction machines actually, and we are well adapted to the induction machine because of its rigidness, and we have a very less maintenance actually when compared with induction, when compared to the PMSM or the synchronous reluctance, you have a very minimal induction machine maintenance actually, and also cost wise it's very cheaper actually. So but when it comes to the applications like that requires very high efficiency, let's say when you are using your for an electric vehicle or something, so where you need a very high precision that actually determines your safety actually, so then the efficiency matters, or your exact precision or exact control matters actually. So there comes the advanced machines like PMSM or synchronous reluctance machines. So where the efficiency when you compare with induction machine, the synchronous reluctance machines have the highest efficiency. So then when it comes to the efficiency part of it is higher, but ultimately there might be having some drawbacks, like you have the cost wise it is very higher than compared with your induction machines actually. So like that you have, either you have the cost wise it is higher, or you have efficiency wise it is lower, so something like that. So based on the application needs again, it's an engineer's and the customer's dependency, which one they want actually. It's either them, they can sacrifice, if they want the efficiency, they can sacrifice a little bit on their cost, and if they want very less cost motor, then they can sacrifice a little bit on their efficiency. So like that, and then they can ultimately decide what motor they have to use it actually. So like that, this table might be easier for them. So coming to one application, so till now we have I have shown what are the basic criteria normally you will be thinking about before performing any automation test, or how you are going to perform the modeling of any setup actually. So when it comes to some applications, so normally in our land test industry, so we normally work mainly on the pumping application, and I'll show you one example actually, one good example how we normally take up some application and how we convert them as a complete product actually. So here is one application, like we have one scenario here, so where there is a water stored in the lower reservoir, and we have a pump here, and this pump is driven by a drive, electric drive. So this pump will be sucking the water from the lower reservoir, and it will be pumping it towards the top reservoir actually here. So it will pop, let's say, first floor, second floor, or something like that. So let's say this is the application we are supposed to develop, and we are supposed to test the drive actually. So normally what we will do, like, first of all, we will be identifying what are the basic parameters, like what is the height of the reservoir, what is the pipe diameter, what is the pipe roughness. So roughness, what I mean is, like, it is the same analogy of electrical resistance, what we have. In electrical domain, you have a resistance, right? So where that opposes the flow of electrons. It's similar to the roughness is like a hydraulic parameter that opposes the flow of water actually. So what is the roughness, internal roughness of the pipe, and what is the pump capacity that you are going to use it, and what is the height of the reservoir that you are supposed to pump the water, and what is the total height between your the top level and the bottom level of water actually. So these are some of the internal values that you might need. So based on the different application, this might differ actually. I'm just taking this as an example. So maybe for different application, you have different parameters actually. So having taken up this, so first we will be going for a modeling. So for a drive, let's say this is a drive that I'm going to develop actually. Let's say I'm going to select a drive for driving the pump actually, what I have taken up. So what I will do is like, first of all, I'll try it in, let's say in a MATLAB or something like that. So I have a slide for you. So first maybe I'll go to the MATLAB section and then I can come back. Yes. So firstly, what I'll do is like, normally in academic, I mean, like, in academic, what you will do is like, you're taking the MATLAB actually, you taking the MATLAB, you draw your all your specifications, let's say, this is a constant head, let's say this is a lower reservoir, and this is a pipe, and what is the flow rate at which the pump is pumping water, and you have the pump. So this is a centrifugal pump model actually. So from there you will be giving to the tank for the higher reservoir actually, like this, and you have all these things available in your MATLAB itself. So you can be able to drag and drop everything, you can decide your, what is the roughness, or what is the inlet pipe diameter, everything you can able to do actually. So based on the parameters, they, you can able to simulate the model, and once the model is fine, then you will go for a hardware realization. So then you won't have any automation, or you won't have any there is no like hardware realization stage before the simulation actually. So once you complete the simulation in MATLAB, then you will be going for a direct hardware actually. But actual scenario in industry is not like that. So first we can go for, this is a pre-modeling stage, like MATLAB modeling in industry is called as a pre-modeling stage. So either you can do this modeling, this is not a 100% required stage in the industry actually. So this is for your safety, in case if you want to perform the simulation, you can do the simulation in MATLAB. So once this is satisfactory to your expectation, then we can go for the next stage, that is the hardware loop. So how hardware loop will look like actually? So this is a window that we normally call as a type of hardware loop. This is like almost 90-95% similar to your MATLAB, but the only difference that makes is like in MATLAB, almost all components what we use it is our ideal components actually, like when we go over for any resistor, capacitor, whatever it is an ideal component. So, but actually the practical scenario will not be like that actually. Whatever the ideal output what you're getting in MATLAB will not be exactly one-on-one matching with your actual hardware. So there comes the exact difficulty actually, where the engineers face the problem. So after you complete your simulation in MATLAB, so when you go for your actual hardware realization, then you face the problem. Then comes this automation techniques, like you have the LabVIEW, you have the iPhone and all this stuff actually. So for that, what we did is like, these are the the practical compounds where you have all this practical concerns are addressed actually. So you have your line resistance, reactants, and next you have your rectifier, and then you have a desync desync capacitance, desync inductance, you can have it in case if you need it. And then you have an inverter system actually, where that will convert your DC voltage to again back to AC voltage actually. So this will be fed to the motor ultimately actually. So you can have your different control techniques if you want actually. You can have different control techniques, as you know, VWAF, FOC, BTC, so like that. So you can take any of the control techniques actually for switching on your inverter drives. So after that, you will be finally going to an, whatever the motor that you selected, whether it can be induction machine, EOSM, or synchronous electrics. So that output of the machine, the shaft power, is being fed to the your pump application. So whatever your outcome you need actually. So how you will be developing the parameters? So now you got the application, like a pumping application you want to work on it. So now for a prime mover, you know that you need to provide a drive, and that has a motor connected towards it actually. So having these two, so how you will be selecting the internal parameters? What is the capacity of the drive I should select? What is the capacity of the motor I should select? What is the capacity of the pump I should select? How will be knowing actually? So for that, we need to come to a load profile actually. Well, normally we call it as a load profile actually. So at different speeds actually, at at the flow rate of, let's say, X amount of flow rate, how much power we should pump to the drive actually. So like that, we should come up with a lower profile actually. So normally for an, let's say for induction machine or for a PMS machine, base mating, might have seen the data sheet actually, how the data sheet will look like. That will be drawn with respect to speed versus torque curve. So this is called as a low profile, they'll be telling like for a speed of, let's say, 1400 RPM, so this much torque should be developed by the motor actually. So that is a load profile. So we'll be first arriving at the load profile. For a pumping system, what, how normally we'll be arriving at a load system is like for a different set of speeds, how the flow rate or the pressure will be exhibited by that particular pump actually. So that's how we develop a load profile initially. So having this load profile, so we'll be tabulating them in terms of values actually. For a speed of 100%, what is a current, what is the head, the pressure, there's a power in terms of watts, HP. So like this, we'll be tabulating in terms of values. So whatever the curve that we have developed, right? So we normally turn in terms of values actually for a different loading actually. This is load one, that is load torque one, load torque two, like that for a maximum, from the minimum to maximum. So for a different operating speeds actually. This operating speed represents the operating speed of the motor actually. For a different speed, let's say if the motor maximum speed is 3000 RPM, till it's 70% or 50% of this operating speed, we will be identifying what are all the possible loading that motor can able to withstand actually. So this is the secondary step actually. We will be identifying what is the load that we are supposed to drive actually. So once this is done, then we will be going for the actual modeling of this entire table actually. Here you can able to find it. Here I have taken up three electrical machines, like see machine 1, machine 2, machine 3. So each machine is driving each different pump actually. So each machine is driven by each different drives actually here. So like this. So we normally, either we can model it in MATLAB first, or you can go directly for your Typhoon Hill actually. So maybe I can show you once in the Typhoon Hill first. I'll just show you. Yeah. So I'll show you the Typhoon Hill page on how it looks like. Yes. Can someone tell me that? Can you able to see the screen now? Is it visible?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. So this is the Typhoon Hill model actually. So normally this is a software where I'll show you the how the software looks like initially. Yes. So this is called the Typhoon Hill Control Center. Maybe some people would have already seen this, and instead of this, some people might have worked on the DSpace actually. So DSpace is one of the you can use it for a pulse generation, or you can use it for a real time application where you can get the real real time data, that is for automation or something. You can get the real time real world data into your simulation for the MATLAB. From there, you can again process the signal, either it can be analog signal or a digital signal. From there, you can process it, and then you can compile your actual model, and then you can send back to the real-time world through SCADA. So it's exactly the similar. You have different applications like this. You have a DSpace, you have a Typhoon Hill, and you have a Plexim. So like this, you have different applications by different vendors actually. So it's ultimately, again, it's a business. Each vendor is providing higher facilities with respect to the cost actually. So we preferred Typhoon Hill, and almost you have the same one or two features lesser or higher in terms of all the Hill platforms, like the hardware and loop platforms actually. So here normally what we'll do is, like, we have a different in the Hill itself we have a different applications, like you have a schematic editor. So this is called schematic editor. So what I'm showing it in the background, right? So you can like, let's say if you click a schematic editor, you can able to open a new window also. So you can go here and you can open a new model. So you can able to decide what is the model that you want to close, so open it, and we can configure all your individual drives, everything here actually. Just to... So this is the schematic editor. So this is first the schematic editor, and schematic editor is exactly similar to your Simlink window actually. Online or MATLAB, right? So we have a Simlink window, we have a command window. So where in the command window we normally write the scripts, right? So, and in the Simlink window we have a drag and drop option actually, and then you can drag and drop all our components, and then we can start doing the simulation. It's a similar way. This is in this automation we will be dragging and dropping all the components like the rectifier section, or you have the each and every resistor, inductors, capacitances, everything you can drag and drop. And finally, once your values are done, then you can ultimately start the simulation. So this is one thing. And second one is like, So second one is like, you have a skill SCADA. So what is, before coming to the T-SCADA, I'll tell you what is a script editor actually. Script editor is exactly same to our command window. What we have our MATLAB, we have a command window, right? So where you can write the simulation as in terms of a script actually. You can write as I showed it here, right? So let me show it in the MATLAB. Yeah, so this is how we normally write it in terms of a simulation code, right, in MATLAB. So we have, let's say if I want to configure the motor coefficients or something, here I have configured the motor coefficients in the command window, MATLAB command window. So similarly, in case if you want to configure or if you want to model them in Typhoon, what we normally do is we go for the script editor window. So where in the script editor, you can able to write all your codings and the MATLAB values. In case if you want to provide any values, right, let's say I'll show you here actually. And in MATLAB, what we will do is, in case if you want to provide any values, rather than directly as a value, if you want to give some generic value, right? So normally what we will do is, we'll provide here as an alphabetic, and there we will be providing the MATLAB script, we will be providing as a values actually. So that the value will be saved in the workspace actually in MATLAB. So similarly here, we will be also providing the name of the inductance or capacitance as some variable, and that variable is will be provided with some constant value in the script editor actually. So it's exactly the similar one, and so that is second one. So once these two things are done actually, so we want to run this model, right? So ultimately the objective is that we want to run the model and we want to see it actually. So yeah, this is how a normal I have taken up just for just for presentation purpose, and we normally will have a voltage, voltmeter, ammeters, all these things will be provided. Let's say if you want to control some of the application, let's say if I want to run any application or something like that. So if we are sliding this, sliding the input parameters, so ultimately the output parameters, the voltage or the current will be varying actually. So currently, since I am not connected to the office server, I will not be able to run it. But in case when we are connected to the office server, right? So once we are changing the input parameters like this, so ultimately the output parameters, you can also be able to see the change in the deflection in the ammeter, voltmeters, all these things. So this is called as the SCADA window actually. So where your the script editor and your Simlink window will be ultimately connected to your SCADA. So this is the ultimate final outcome the engineer or the customer will be visualizing actually. So these are the main part. And finally, that comes the automation part. So where the automation test suits, all these things are saved actually. So this is a test suit actually. So where you can be able to configure your test suit, all these things actually. So since I'm not connected with this office server now, maybe I'll not be able to open this test suit. So I'll open it in a separate window actually. So normally how we will do the test suit and how testing we will be doing it actually. I'll show it in a separate window now. So this is the thing. Once the modeling, everything is done in the Typhoon, so we'll go for the test suit. So how we'll be making the test suit? So testing of a drive, that comes in two packages. One is you can do it manually. Let's say you are given with the one drive. So once the modeling is done, everything, and all your results are satisfactory, and you feel that you are expecting the exact outcome for your motor or for your pump, whatever you want to develop actually.
So once this is done, right, so what you will do is you will go for the hardware realization, exact hardware realization of the drive. You will provide the capacitance value, resistance value, whatever you have taken up in the simulation, right, you will give it in the direct hardware actually. So once that is done, so you will get the hardware in your hand actually, the drive, electric drive in your hand actually. So then before giving it to the customer, before delivering it to the customer, you are supposed to test it actually as an industry when you are supplying something to a customer, right? So normally you will be testing it before them as a quality check, as an ISO test. You will be performing all the tests actually, as a performance test, and you have the quality checks, everything you will be doing it actually. As a part of performance test, what normally you will be doing it is like, you have two things. One is either it can be done manually, all the parameters, all the performance are exactly same as expected by the customer actually. You can do it manually, that is one way. Another one is like doing it in an automation way. So automation way is part that we are seeing it now actually. So when it comes to the SCADA, you can able to design the automation steps, like in terms of Python or in terms of some coding languages, you can able to design. When you want to, when you are giving a voltage of, let's say, 230 volts as an input supply voltage, and what should be the expected torque value, what should be the expected speed value, what should be the expected flow rate of the pump. So like this, we have a individual, one by one, actually, what are all the different test cases we need to test it, actually. So likewise, we'll be testing it, actually. So that is called the test suite, automation test suite. Another one is a manual test suite. Normally, people you might have tested in your lab, actually. Like, when you want to test, let's say, if you want to test your transformer, right? So you might have studied in your courses. So what normally we'll do is like OC test, SC test. So like that, you will perform all the tests and then you will know down the values, like, so for this particular voltage, this is the expected secondary voltage, and this is the, for this particular input power, this much secondary power should be obtained actually. So that is the input and output values that we will be noting out. So that will be cross reference with respect to some bookmarks actually. So you already have some benchmark values for, let's say, 2 kVA transformer, this should be the outcome value for X amount of input actually. So like that, you will be having some benchmark values. With that, you will be cross-referencing actually. So when that matches, you will come to a conclusion that your transformer is working fine and you can deliver it to the customer. So similarly, we'll be doing it here, no automation actually, like this. And coming back to the presentation, yes. So this was a MATLAB simulation. Normally, we will be doing it actually once for the pre-simulation check, I mean actually. So having these two things, like in the simulation, what we'll be observing is like whether the coefficients, whatever I have modeled, right? So whether that is taking up in the right path, like from 0 to 100 kilowatt ranging, whether from the zero, that means whatever the 0%, the minimum loading percentage, the maximum loading percentage, whether whatever the expected curve is matching or not actually. So like that we'll be observing. So these are mainly application oriented things, but you need to understand, like, so before going to the direct exact hardware modeling, what are the different things that you do actually, like for a different power ratings, whether you are able to get the expected outcome actually or not. So this I have shown here as one of the application that how normally we'll test it actually. So this is the connected here, right? So these are the drives, and this is a drive till now you are seeing about in the modeling. So see, this is the exact modeling of the particular drive I'm showing it in the hardware actually. So this is in the simulation, and this is motor, and this is the entire drive actually, and this is a machine, and from here you will be connecting to a pump actually. So when it comes to the real-time hardware, so these are the different drives. And you can see here, right, these are the black color things are the motors. So you have all the three are PLSM motors, thermal magnet synchronous machine motors. And all the three white color things are nothing but the centrifugal pumps actually. So you have three centrifugal pumps connected by three PMSM motors, and these are driven by three electric drives actually. So these drives are being connected to LabVIEW setup. So this is a LabVIEW setup, or you can have the Typhoon Hill setup. So we have two setups also connected here. One is a LabVIEW setup and another one is a Typhoon Hill setup actually. So based on which automation you want to run the test suite, we can be able to run it. When you want to connect it through the LabVIEW setup and you want to control the drives through LabVIEW, that automation, that is possible. When you want to control the entire test setup with your hill, it is also possible. Now, you have connected this with the heat setup, and in case while running, right, you want to observe what are the outcome parameters, let's say the power quality parameters or the drive output parameters or the pump output parameters. See here, when the pump is running, you can able to observe here what is the flow rate at which it is running. So this is called the flow meter badge, and you have the pressure badges. So like that, you have a different sensors, and you have a different meters to observe the what is the outcome actually that we are getting it actually. So some outcomes that I'll show you here actually, some like power quality, mainly like when you are running any automation test, right? So normally first thing normally we will consider is our performance actually. That is the expected performance, whether it is working fine or not. Second one is like, do we see any adverse things actually? Like let's say when you are running your electric drive, that is power electronic components, right? So we might fell into injecting some of the harmonics into the input power grids actually. So power quality is very, very important actually when you are running our electric drives actually. So that only people like IEEE norms, they have scheduled us for, like you should maintain your TSD less than 5%, less than 12%. So we have scheduled norms actually. So based on that, our drive should comply on that particular norms actually. So what we will do is like we'll go for one minute. So based on that, we'll go for a power quality checking actually. Let's say on the input side as well as the output side for a different voltages, let's say different loadings actually, from 25% of loading to 100% of loading, right? So how the power quality actually matters, the input side as well as the output side. So here you can able to see it. So these are the output voltages now I have shown here, right? The output voltage of the drive, and this is the input current and input voltage of the drive. And similarly, this is in the R phase, and this is Y phase and B phase. Both on the input and the output, I have shown it here actually. So like this, I have tested for the 25% of loading, from the minimal loading to 100% loading. So
students, any queries? Sir, actually in your presentation you have shown a power analyzer. It is a fluke type, sir. Okay. A PQ box. Okay. Power quality analyzer. Okay. Actually, this waveform you have take it from DSO, na? It is a DSO waveform, right? DSO, digital storage oscilloscope. Okay. Okay. Because in the institutions, normally in colleges or university, they are not having this. They are having only fluke type. It is fluke type 3 channel voltage and 3 channel current, 500 volt RMS and 5 ampere current will be available. And if I want to get this type of display, I have to connect the 5 channel CRO, TMS channels, DSO. It is available in the market, so we have to use it. Because that is the additional facility. Okay, sir. Okay. Thank you, sir. Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Okay. Yes, sir. Because usually in the institutions, sir, in the institutions lab classes, we won't use the fluke type for undergraduate level. This is only applicable for postgraduate and PhD students. They can use it for research purpose. Okay, students, any queries? Have any queries? Okay. Now I request Mr. Dinesh to give the vote of thanks. Mr. Sir, really your presentation is more helpful for our student community, sir, because the students are from sixth semester, that is third year undergraduate level, electrical engineering. So the presentation is very impressive and it's more understandable for them to continue with the project purpose, that is like mini project or main project, whatever it may be. And with your busy schedule, you have accepted my invitation and you have given an excellent presentation for my students. On behalf of our New Horizon College of Engineering, Bangalore, I really thank today's speaker, Mr. Arun Shankar from Danfoss Industry. Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Okay, sir. Thank you, students. I have posted the feedback and attendance link in the chat box. Please give your attendance and feedback link. And the link will be active only for 5 minutes. Okay? Thank you. Thank you for attending this. No problem. Ma'am, the same attendance only it is applicable, ma'am. Then I will segregate A and B separately and I will send it to B section. No, ma'am, actually I already have the attendance link along with the feedback. Okay, the combination of both. So I will separate the B section and I will send it to you and Vinod Kumar sir for attendance purpose. Okay, ma'am. Okay, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you, students. You may leave. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.